people in this audience, and so I feel pretty comfortable. I'm glad to see everybody here. And on behalf of the UCLA School of the Arts and Architecture and the Herb Alpert School of Music, I'd like to welcome you to tonight's presentation, Play and Creativity in Art Teaching, by Dr. George Szekely. I'm Barbara Drucker, the Associate Dean of Community Engagement and Arts Education and Founding Director of the Visual and Performing Arts Education Program at UCLA, otherwise known as VAPA. Tonight's presentation is the fourth and final event in this year's VAPA Public Lecture Series, exploring a range of challenging topics that promote arts equity, access, and high-quality arts education strategies. Funded by a UCLA Arts Initiative grant, this series represents an ongoing collaboration between VAPA and our colleagues in the Graduate School of Education and Information Studies, the Luskin School of Public Affairs, and the Herb Alpert School of Music. I would especially like to thank our host for this evening's event, the Department of Music Education, and specifically Professors Lily Chen Haftek and Frank Huser, for facilitating the use of this wonderful space and supporting tonight's program. Before I introduce tonight's speaker, please let me tell you a little bit about the VAPA program. Established in 2010 as the first school-wide minor in the School of the Arts and Architecture, VAPA is an innovative arts education program that fosters the creative and intellectual growth of UCLA students while providing much-needed arts education curricula to children and families in underserved communities. In addition to its full range of undergraduate course offerings, workshops, and public events, VAPA provides in-school and after-school arts programming in over 15 schools in the Los Angeles area, in addition to professional development opportunities and a broad range of original projects, including the award-winning Classroom in Residence program developed in partnership with the Hammer Museum. Created by artist educators, emphasizing experiential learning and creative process at the core of its curriculum, VAPA introduces UCLA undergraduates to the rich history of arts education in the United States, emphasizing the crucial role the arts play in a diverse society. VAPA is committed to community engagement and aims to be a catalyst for positive change in urban arts education. VAPA is led by a strong team of artist educators, including Dr. Kevin Kane, our associate director, and Lindsay Lindberg, our program coordinator. Last year, VAPA was selected for the 2015 Community Program of the Year Catalyst Award, presented annually by the City of Los Angeles in collaboration with UCLA to honor programs that have made a significant impact in the community in a short period of time. Obviously, we're all very proud of this program, which would not be possible with the support of our generous donors, including the Rosenthal Family Foundation, the Ring Foundation, Harold Williams and Nancy Englander, Shirley and Ralph Shapiro, Alan M. Schwartz, and Interim Dean David Rousseff and the UCLA School of the Arts and Architecture. Tonight's program is a wonderful culmination of a lecture series that began last October with a presentation by Dr. Winnie Wicks discussing the lifelong impact that the artist teacher Frieda Dicker Brandeis had on her students in the Terezin concentration camp in World War II. Followed in November by a panel discussion and presentation by Dr. Steve Seidel entitled Questions of Quality: What is High Quality Arts Education and Why Does It Matter? Our third event in this series was an experiential workshop facilitated by Michael Rode, focused on community dialogue and civic practice, which all leads up to tonight's presentation, Play and Creativity in Art Teaching, by Dr. George Szekely. Since 1969, Dr. Szekely has pioneered creative principles and innovative methodologies in the field of arts teaching. As an artist and researcher, Dr. Szekely has received the Manuel Barkin Prize, the Victor Lowenfeld Award, and the Marion Dixon Award. He is a distinguished fellow and president-elect of the National Association of Art Education. In addition to more than 150 journal and magazine articles, Dr. Szekely has authored 12 books, including From Homework to School Art, Video Art for the Classroom, The Art of Teaching Art, and Play and Creativity in Art Teaching. and yet another book to be published this year entitled Art and Design Education, Art Rooms as Centers of Innovation. Dr. Szekely's contributions to teacher education are best exemplified in his Adopt a School project, the first field-based art education program in the nation, now a widely emulated and award-winning model for preparing future art teachers. His writings were among the first to emphasize the importance of children's play and home art in artistic development and as a foundation of school art. Dr. Szekely's writings and films create vivid portraits of significant creative moments in children's lives and celebrate the artist in every child and every human being. Dr. Szekely's research continues to question the current wisdom of presenting adult images, techniques, and ideas in art classes for children. He views teaching as an art medium and the art room as a canvas. He discusses art lessons as creative works, envisioned and planned as art forms, requiring a full range of imaginative ideas and resources. George Szekely is a practicing artist, a prolific painter with over 26 solo exhibitions in New York and throughout the United States and Europe. His art has been reviewed in Art Forum, Art News, and The New Yorker. He's a graduate of the High School of Music and Art in New York City, received his BFA from Cooper Union, MFA from Pratt Institute, Master's in Art Education from NYU, and his doctorate from Teachers College at Columbia University. He has taught in New York City Public Schools at Hunter College and the City University of New York, and since 1978 has been area head and senior professor of art at the University of Kentucky. Please join me in welcoming Dr. George Szekely.
Thank you very much. And thank you, by the way, for the attendance taking. You know, we always take attendance in school. That's funny because my very first year of teaching, I went to the principal's office. Not a pleasant place to go to. But a little boy was sitting next to me and making conversation, trying to calm him down. What did you do? What earth-shaking? I wrote on the chalkboard. Okay. I know that there are some students who get lost between their classroom in elementary school and the art room that you have to take attendance, or maybe it's a legal matter. But I use attendance taking and drawing on the chalkboard or the dry erase board as fun, as a rehearsal, as reminiscing of ideas of childhoods. And it's one of the favorite activities of students. If I forget to put the attendance symbol on, one of the kids will go up and just do it. While you came in, there was a screen up here. And it was so nice to reminisce. It was my children, they're now in their 28? Okay. And they were little kids here. These are home movies, kind of flickering home movies. And with a certain charm to them. One of the things I like to talk about is this graduation to become an art teacher. I never really felt like an art teacher before we had our children. And I had a chance to really observe what art teaching without an art teacher is about. And can that actually happen? Can you really have children make art without an art teacher? So I spend a great deal of my time in observing children and also taking my students. Student teaching is very nice. You observe teachers. You've been a student in art classes, those of you are teaching art yourselves. But it's not the same as observing children. The only problem I have are the parents who say, can I clean it up before you come to see the kids' room? said, no, that's not the idea. We don't clean anything up. We want to see their creations. And so as part of our teaching, student teaching, by the way, student teaching was always a funny word. I always thought of student teaching as the students teaching us, the art teachers. It's kind of a different. But I graduated from art school and started teaching at that time. We didn't have student teaching. So I truly looked upon my job, I looked upon the my task is to learn from the students. And so that was a very exciting period. And it's almost like Picasso, you know, discovering African art. You know, it was art unlike I've ever seen in museums, that I've seen in art school, which is very similar. And so it was quite a difference. And I date my becoming an art teacher from that period of observing the children. And it was so much that I've learned from them. It's my spot. You know, it was my youngest daughter used to say to me, "Dad, you never play with me." Now look at me, come on, look at me. Do I look like a dad who doesn't play with their children? "Okay, Dad, come into my room." Says, "Let's make something." It's not, "Dad, give me an art lesson." Okay, "What is the art lesson today, Dad?" "Let's make something." Okay, she just wants me on the floor. And she goes around the house and goes shopping, right? And goes shopping everywhere. And then when she's ready and has the things that she wants, we get started. And it's simple as that. I trust her, and she trusts very much that, you know, that I will support her ideas, that I will be working on my own work and not really interfering or every minute being in control of driving the children's work. You know what that feels like, right? It's many teachers driving the children's work. So you cannot live by art lessons alone. That is a dead end. And so observing children, you develop this incredible faith in children as artists. And you really have this sense that you can go into the school and they are the stars of the class. Their art really is their ideas. They bring their collections. You have to be a trusted person. You know, it's a very high honor. The trusted person. I can show this to the art teacher, so they little pockets, or they open their little lunch boxes, you know, which are safes. And at the risk of somebody taking it away from them, you know, they bring the little lunch box and open it and show it to you. But to you, the trusted art teacher. So in observing, as you saw on the little home videos, there's just so much I've learned from the kids. First of all, very simply moving the art class to the floor. The floor is the play space. The desk in school is the scary space. It's the test-taking space. It's the space that you are going to be judged on. You are going to, there are certain pressures involved. It's a hard desk. It's an unforgiving surface. It's not a fun surface to work on. It's a limited, it's a canvas that outlines another canvas. So just move it to the floor. Play is on the floor. You can buy kids the most expensive desk to do their homework with the best intentions, and they will still work on the floor and put their coats and everything else piled up on their desks. So you use the floor. And You know, it's not very hard to tell the artist's room. And by the mid-70s, right, Laura, we had our children, we had three artists in residence, all working and doing fabulous things. I remember one day the children were in school, and I know you didn't like this, I'm sorry, Laura, but I actually took the door, you go to the doors, you see this wonderful artworks on children's doors. It's amazing. And you know, it's so funny because I still hear teachers coming to me frequently and saying, I spent my whole lunch period, gave up everything to do the bulletin board or to do the door. When you have door artists right there with great experience. So look at the kids' resumes. And their resumes are rich. But they don't see the connection between the art that is made in school. It's foreign. They come over to you, what are we going to? And not very happily many times. You know, what's up? What are we going to do today? You know, tell me what to do. I'll do it. Or I'm not good in art. You know. But what may not look familiar to them, and I remember when I was a younger teacher, what was not familiar is Szekely's art. Because I became an expert in shading, in design elements, in perspective, and all the shticks of adult art. And I saw kids coming in as a blank slate, and I was going to give them a makeover, an art makeover, right? Doesn't work. It's also disrespectful. This is not what you want. If you were an artist, somebody do to you, whether you're an adult or a child. So treating young artists with respect means that you're preparing them to come into class as well prepared as you are. That they come in with little ideas, little drawings, little stories. And you take the time to listen to them, that they are the stars. Listen to them. And the first few minutes of the period is all important. Who leads that first part of the period? Does it start with, this is what we're going to do today, whether you like it or not? So just taking the time to listen to the amazing things, their clothing, and they spend a lot of time in mismatching, in matching and mismatching, and bringing in the latest in backpacks and umbrellas and children's socks, just noticing the things that they bring to the room. Don't ignore any of the small things. So this feeling of the kids the job of the art teacher is preparing the kids to come into the art room and come in with ideas and having somebody there who is receptive to those ideas and trying to make that happen. The same way, what happens when the children leave the room? Very important. Again, the same thing. Prepare them for art, for life beyond the art room. What's going to happen for the rest of the day when they go home? That you build this excitement to do things. What are you going to do? What are you going to make? You know, how is this going to? And many of the things we do are actually toys, playable artworks, things that you can pull and push, that you can reset up, that you can play with. Refrigerator art is tossed, you know, and it's if the parents are careful, of course, they toss it without the children knowing. Ha, ha, ha. The children know. My children used to know anything that I threw out in the trash can that they told me the night before, don't throw it out. When I threw it out, they knew it. The same way. When something disappears from the refrigerator. So it's not refrigerator art that we're making. We're making art for the living room. We're making art for prime spaces. We make art that's playable, that's usable. So many of these things that I'm talking about, you saw in the video, basically. And using, for example, everything around, that everything is an art supply. I was actually fired. Don't spread the word. I was fired by Crayola. And it's okay. It's one of the little known facts. I was supposed to travel around their exhibits and say wonderful things about the exhibits. And in one night, there was somebody in the audience, one of the Crayola executives that I didn't have the smarts to figure out who he was. And I talked about the world being the children's art supply store, that children find the best art supplies. And it may not necessarily be Crayola. I got my pink slip very soon. And I was very happy about it to a degree, although it was very nice little extra income. But the Crayola art show is such an example of art, of adult art actually put into a frame. And it's supposedly made by children. Children are artists. Their artworks are unique. They're not like adult art. They have their own media. They have their own way of working, their own themes. So the Crayola people are not happy that I didn't appreciate their miniature adult works. Okay, I lived through it. But so what I wanted to share with you is this lifelong study of children's art is what the role of the art teacher is. Yes, you may need a master's or an advanced degree, and you may want to get it online and make a decision whether to take it in class, whatever. But don't forget to study children. Study them in the park. Study them in the aisles of stores, from supermarkets to toy stores. Play with children. Unless you have played with children, you cannot be an art teacher. But you may have played with them years ago as a babysitter, but keep playing with them, because you need to keep that refreshed in your mind what children's art is about. And you need to have that faith in children that, yes, the less instruction, the better. The silence here. The less instruction is better. And you develop that by playing with children. So spend time regularly playing with children. Anyway, obviously, you know that when you play with children, you have a wealth of artworks that you can share with children. And what you see in many art rooms, you see the great masters, and I've nothing against that. Wonderful. You sometimes see some old posters that were there for 15 years, and if you dust them, take that poster down, come on. Your work is probably equally important. Make sure you have your works on the wall in your art room, but also to feature kids' artworks. So when you see in the movie, for example, in this family videos, all these works constantly travel to class. So when the children made Anna, for example, she loved to make her own birthday present. She wanted to know what she's getting. Can't cheat me, you know. But she wanted to wrap it up. Probably Christo also. That's where he got. So made the most amazing wrappings. This wrappings playing post office, very much children's art. Used to bring that into school. So bringing in these wonderful things, and one of the hardest things I brought to school was a donut factory made out of probably 4 or 5 different boxes with all kinds of toppings, you know, eraser parts, parts of different color rubber bands, different toppings, and then the line, the assembly line. And I'm glad my son isn't here tonight, because one of my daughters, she ripped it off his G.I. Joe tanks, and so connected the donut factory. So with great care, I packaged this big thing and brought it to school. Now, kids who did not recognize school art, what is this school art? All of a sudden saw a relationship between their own work and the work that's being celebrated. And it also gives confidence, and it confirms the value of children's art and the art of... It's a life changer in your art class. So, okay with the old masters, but make sure you show lots of children's works. And in their unique media, it's not so hard. Children create the most amazing cork boards, bulletin boards. It's not so hard to take off that cork board, right? And to bring it to class as an example of great artwork, and so on and so forth. So many of these wonderful creations. So make sure that children's art is seen as legitimate. You're legitimizing children's art. And you're telling kids that the artists are not those people who are... Art is not dead. It's been done by adults. All you have to do is copy it. Okay? Art is not... It's alive. It's for you to invent. And the idea in art teaching is having kids search for their own art. The idea in art teaching on all levels is for us to search for our own art. Now, that can be made more difficult by art teaching, or that can open up the world for kids. Once they think of everything as an art supply, everything as an art tool, everything as an art media, you're opening up in different ways the art world to them. Many times, I remember when I first saw, we went into a class, this was funny. I thought it was funny. What are you doing today, I asked. I was a visitor. We're doing Jackson. Jackson? All together, the kids say. We're doing Jackson. Say it. Bollock. Okay. While Jackson may have been honored, but kids are the inventors of line. Give them an extension cord. Give them a garden hose. The way they tie their shoelaces. Children are the line artists. The way children set the table, amazing. At home we have fiesta ware, but I also love different kinds of paper and plastic dishes. So the kids' job is to set the table, and they love doing it. So bring it into school. And the dinner table, right? Adults always take credit for children's art. Doesn't it aggravate you? It aggravates me, right? They make the big money, the auction, and so forth. Yet kids invented modern art in every way. Earthworks, really? Earthworks? Come on, come on. Who's getting the credit for that? So whether you play with them in the backyard of the school, I love the school hallways, every school space. Every school furniture is important. From one chair, it can be a chair lift. The kids will design hot air balloon rides from the chair. They will put it together like a race car. Every piece of furniture, the table in a school, the top of the table becomes, in the children's imagination, they will come up with cooked up. Why not? It's a chef's magic kitchen. It's a test kitchen. Okay. They will play under the table. My private studio. We do need privacy. So when you're on the floor, you can have your private studio. All kinds of possibilities with every piece of furniture. If you have not seen a space launch, you have not been to Cape Kennedy. I haven't been there either, Sessions. But a child in a big trash can, or one of the things that I learned from, again, observing children at laundry days. I remember with my wife, Laura, doing laundry, and the kids loved the laundry baskets. And they climbed inside. It became a spaceship. They took the pop covers, and it became something to drive, a race car. And so all these things, what you see is the seeds of what can come into school. So when the kids play with Tupperware at home and create magnificent buildings, they pile up the toilet paper, right? All of these are things that you're always getting new supplies in the art room, so they can design the interior and pile up different kinds of... everything can be translated or brought to school. It's not hard to do. And I'm not talking about a Broadway show, but still, what you observe with kids can easily come into school. I have to get up because my legs are falling asleep. Sorry. I always tell my wife, Laura, that I'm going to retire when I can't really get up because I'm all day sitting on the floor with kids. So I still got up, thank you.
Way where they can get beautiful, your favorite things, the things that they dream about. my wife is laughing because I used to call her Montessori Fritz, taking my kids to Montessori's. And by the time we made the circle, you know, I started warning the kids, you know, you can't take that to school, that to school, that to school, that to school. And there's not much left, you know, we made a Wall Street job. But the stuff that they loved, cared about, had interest in, you know, stayed home and stayed in their degrees. There's no reason in an art room where some things can be in the art room and shared rooms. So invite friends of all kinds. This band had a study life. Didn't you? In Hungary during the summer we didn't wear shoes because we were waiting for our school shoes to be made. Shoes were made for six. But this bear had shoes. I made shoes for this bear. That was fabulous. I dressed the bear. I made parks, schools, when he was sick, for certain infirmary and veterinarian's office and everything else that you could think of to keep this bear happy. So cheap bottle also, the bear bottle throwing, you know, very good ways. celebrate birthday parties. Kids love to bring their favorite. There's nothing secret. There's nothing more fascinating and exciting than having kids draw something that they love. If your child is taking Suzuki lessons, I remember our kids, all four of them, we were very fond of them. But the first violin they got, the first real violin, the first one they play a box, that's the first one. And then they get the drawings, and even facings, but of the first violin, just imagine the drawings. Kids' drawings of the old teddy bear, amazing drawings. Artworks in school, well, they're just exercises. You hear this in foundations classes, you hear this in many classes, they're just exercises, they're doing exercises. Kids are not into exercises. They're into making love from the heart. They're making it as gifts for special people. You know, my colleagues talk about the show I'm going to have, I'm going to sell this, and this is not for you. They make it for special people. You, the teacher, the parents, the grandparents. One of the kids made this beautiful bed and quilt for his sister. Not just the work, but the love that went into it. So the artwork has to be really, it's not an exercise. And if the meaning comes from the artist, is that artist talking to you? I'm not telling you anything. You, why should it change in teaching? I don't understand that. It should be something different. So what's, you know, there has to be some reason and meaning importance behind that work. And that can only come from the artists, from the children. Anyway. Now, you know, after World War II, there were plenty of junk on the streets. And I remember this is making this amazing school. It's an amazing scooter for them. But kids playing, the figures, play figures of all kinds, whether it's Polly Pockets, larger figures, statue figures, these are kids' first loves, their first experiences, the figures of art. It's a lifelong love for the figure that these play things represent. They must be part of the art class. The small Hot Wheel cars, the wonderful small toys that they buy from
levels. I thought, oh, that's great. Make the classroom. They call me the moving man because I'm constantly coming in and playing with the classroom. It's one of when it was mentioned that I call the classroom as our canvas. It is. You can see beyond the floor. It's magical. You can see Jacques Cousteau swimming on the. You look out the window and you see. You raise the ceiling, you know, and you see the heavens. You can do anything with your classroom. With minor changes, your classroom can become a different place every time. And it's not the idea of chaining kids to desks and seats, or to keep this. You know, it's this. You know yourself as an artist. You need freedom to move. You need space. You need to. You know, so the idea of sitting at desks, you know, of having these routines and having handed to kids all the time. I don't understand that. You mean kids don't like to shop? So kids shop outside of school. Ask kids, what is the most interesting place to find stuff? And they will come up. The bike store. Monday they take the trash out. It's on Euclid, the bike store. You go there, you'll find the greatest things. You know, just consult the kid. They come up with great places to find things. So they need to shop before class. The classroom needs to be this amazing shopping site. And it can be filled with all kinds. They love little drawers, makeup drawers, fish and tackle boxes. They love suitcases. But so it can be one of the most. I call it the piazza. You know what the piazza is in Hungarian? It's the great big marketplace. And it's this wonderful trading and contributing and bringing in and sharing beautiful finds. And you have to have it in your class. It can be on a projector. It can, you know, in art class, we work with our hands. In other classes, they use the technology and so forth. I mean, sometimes we need it, and I have it in my room too. But it's building, it's making, is what we're about. And it's not STEM or STEAM or clouds, whatever. You know, it's we. You know, we are doing this. We have always done this. So don't follow the bandwagon. Be careful. Art education has always followed bandwagons in education. Like, they really know the best way to teach. And be careful of that. You know, I mean, we are the center of innovation, and art class has always been the center of innovation. I've been going around, I know it sounds crazy, but I've been making these big placards. I've been giving them away, and teachers put them on their classrooms. The art room, the center of innovation in the school. Makes a big difference. You know, and we are. This was, I guess it's not the McCarthy era, so I'm safe to say. I was a young pioneer. It's the young communist. I had no interest in it. But everybody in Hungary in my day had to go to the young pioneers. You did your homework there. You played either table tennis, it was almost called it ping pong, it's table tennis, or you played chess. So you can imagine how eager I was to teach my children. By the way, this is the original young pioneer set that I was given, because very few people at that time were able to leave the country, and I was one of the fortunate ones. So. This was a gift. And this will be great. I'm going to teach them chess. This is the way you set up the pieces, and this is how it goes on the board, and we went through, and the kids were actually very patient, very polite. And then they said, I'll show you how to play, Dad. Well, first, they played on this side of the board. And it became a wedding. And guess who got married? So, children will change the rules of the game. Isn't that what art is about? Ilona, my oldest, she wanted to learn ping pong. And that was a young pioneer game. I was an expert. If I could avoid the lectures, I'd rather play ping pong. So again, show her the game and this, you know, whole distance. Very nice, polite, patient. Dad, now let me show you how. We can't do it here. But we went under the table. It was supposed to be played, I bet you didn't know this. It was supposed to be played under the table. And the racket, instead of holding it by the handle, it was the reverse. And you hit it with the wood part. Why not? And there are so many examples. If you're a child watcher, a child observer, these wonderful tea parties underwater. And you may have seen some of the children when they have tea parties underwater. They make up those fantastic games. And so much of art, you know, you take art classes, you get art degrees. I shouldn't say this, perhaps. You may get fired like Crayola. so much is unlearning the learning that you have in your art school days. And finding your own art. And that's about art teaching. Helping kids to find their own art. Again, it will not work with the lesson plan. It will not work with this is what we're going to do today. It's discovering your own art. And many times it frees you so much by having the kids change the rules of the game. I go out, for example, and we're going repainting, and the kids love to paint. We had a very nice backyard in one of the schools that I work with. And we go outside and say, gee, you know, I forgot the brushes. They said, don't worry, teacher. You know, and they're all over. They're looking, and you know, there's mosses, there's grasses, there are twigs. They bring you these great brushes. Do you have tape? The kids go through tape. That's one of the first, because it's like cutting is a drawing media of kids. Scotch tape, all kinds of tapes is their drawing media. But you don't have any more tape? So I said, I don't. So I go to the, I shouldn't do this. But I go to the first aid box, and I take out some of the Band-Aids. And first thing, what is that's not tape. But then they start laughing. Wow. And, well, you know, the big fashion line tapes are worth $8,000-$9,000 by famous designers. But kids have always, I have a boo-boo. Do you know I have a boo-boo? And they've always played with these Band-Aids and created some amazing things. So, you know, again, this it's wonderful child watching. And a couple of more things I wanted to show you. This, by the way, is very interesting. This was next to my bed when I was a child. And we had a very cold house. There were allotments for coal in Europe at that time after the war. And so my parents placed this next to my bed. And it was sold by gypsies. They rolled it up and they had it on their shoulders. Well, one of the things you learn as a Hungarian kid, is not to let gypsies in. But I had such a feeling for for gypsies that I couldn't do that. I couldn't do that. So we ended up with these wonderful rugs. And what I'm suggesting is an open house. I'm not talking about as a realtor. That's another matter. But to have an open house for the kids to browse, to shop, to borrow things. The pillows, the flashlights, to look through toolboxes, to look through the kitchen drawer. By the way, it's my wife's birthday, and I'm safe now to confess. It's one time she thought we were robbed. I took the kitchen drawer to school because there's so many interesting things. And I like the first-hand experiences. Let the kids go through the kitchen drawer. Oh, and now that we're rolling, I also took the pop cover that was missing. We have a lot of kids who love to drive in class. And driving, of course, requires a steering wheel and pop covers. Anyway, not okay. No more. Anyway, so open the house, let them shop. They build with, they construct with, they invent with. Everything. And one of the things I remember, she took a bath. And she had the towels around her head, like almost like super girl, this cape. She sat on this carpet and put the fan behind her and was waiting for a liftoff. Now, you wouldn't believe it because these are semester I had, I switch every semester, elementary to middle school. I had middle schoolers, and they loved flying carpets. They also loved making airports. They really redesigned. So the future is in the kids. Futurism, the future, is in kids' hands. So in terms of designing the latest in iPhones, the latest in airports, anything, the kids do an amazing job. Latest in toothbrushes, especially familiar. They made, you may have seen on the site, the wonderful flashlights they designed, the next generation of flashlights, or these drink containers that you have in your hand. Yeah. I mean, they're beautiful shapes. I started collecting them. But and also your collections. We all collect as artists. We're known for collectors, right? And don't go for this word that we're hoarders, okay? That's entirely something else. We're collectors. And our collections are extremely meaningful to our students. They will remember it. You don't want to teach any lesson that's not memorable. Many times, I liked my elementary school teacher, my elementary school art teacher. Not quite sure what we did in that class. Don't teach any lessons that are not memorable. Don't teach any lessons that are not your lessons. It's an artwork, as you said. You can't get it from the art teacher down the hall or school arts or reading it somewhere on a website. You have to have a stake in it. You have to be surprised. And you need to make teaching art fun for yourself as well. You're the best people. The art teachers are the kindest people. But at the same time, it's something that you have to do things for yourself sometimes. So to have an interest in what's going to happen today in class. So set up a lesson where you have all these wonderful surprises. Don't you want to be showered by surprises? Who wouldn't? So I urge you to keep the lessons fun and surprising for yourself. Make it fun for yourself. Okay, down we go. Did I forget something? The carpet is to have the things in the house available. The pillows, I buy pillows at Goodwill. I usually have used books the kids build with. They enjoy very much, so I always have lots of used books in my class. I have carpet pieces that they like to. This golf game that I might have mentioned before, the child who found this green carpet in the trash and made this amazing golf game using plastic forks and spoons. By the way, observing kids, it's very important to do it in, you may not like this, but to take cafeteria duty. I know. It has its problems. But you find so many, I mean, some of the best Broadway shows I saw in the cafeteria. And they were simply between a half-eaten apple, a banana, and some tin foil performed on the stage of a lunchbox. Or a child who wants to make a phone call and pops up that little straw, from the juice container and tries to call someone. I mean, you can go on and on of what you observe children invent in the lunchroom. I see something down here. This is my old school bag. And every time the teacher had, this is from Vienna, after we tried to escape from Hungary, waiting for American Quarter. And as I went to school in Vienna for a couple of years, the teacher had this, every single student had this, talking about saying this. Every child had the same matching pencil case. But even in this pencil case, there is an element of fun. In 19, let's say 15 Mercedes. It was lovely. My teacher, Herr, you have to call him Herr Professor Doctor Manfreda. This was the elementary school. This was his book for teaching art. Read the second letter. And read the second letter starts out with a 10-page thesis on how to sharpen your pencil. Anyway, it was quite different than Mr. Williams, my art teacher, in Vienna, in America. So I had an art teacher in Vienna who was also very interesting. And he was in a school full of abandoned children who got separated from their parents during the crossing of the border. And he treated me, this art teacher really treated me as if I was 65 also. And I was just another artist. That's something to think about, tonight. It's this respect for the other artists in the class. Knowing who the artists in the class. And it's not the art teacher. I had a great idea, so I'm going to teach this to the kids. And that's not going to go there. I have graduate students who come to me, my doctoral students get one independent study course. And they come to me always with this question, what do you want me to do? Too late. I'm so much earlier, think for yourself. That's where we come in, and that's our specialty. The teaching for artistic independence is crucial. But as I said, I was watching with amazement the American children bringing in this wild briefcases,
backpacks and lunchboxes, God, and all kinds of Western scenes and space scenes. Decorated backpacks with art exhibits, kind of moving art exhibits with different keychains on it, let's say, and stickers, and really art things. So this bag, in some ways, makes sense, because I kept the bag when I was, although I was making fun of it, I must say, I kept the bag in my American school, and I started to see the pencil sharpening could be not in my favorite style. I was talking about Mr. Williams. Mr. Williams, I didn't speak English, so Mr. Williams sat inside the table for me. And she calls. my daughter, my youngest, needs babysitting for a week. And there goes my wife. But she always sends me back presents. And she found this in the schoolyard. She doesn't know what it is, but she knows that Grandpa would appreciate it. And that's the stage where the kids become your collectors. Collectors, when they trade, when they're bringing things that they don't really care about what it's supposed to be used for. But you find new uses for everything. She also sent me another question. Oh, here. I thought, Grandpa, this would be great. Now, it's just gorgeous, and you know, on a line, you hear this all the time on this supermarket line. The child picks up things in the aisle and wants to buy them. And then there's a parent, a gatekeeper, who said, "We have so much of that at home. Do you want more junk at home? What are you going to use that for anyway?" If they took 2 minutes just to ask the kids, actually, seriously, and it's taking the audience seriously, what can you use these things for? They don't come up like that, and not only are our students, including myself, you can come up that fast with ideas of what that choice could be used for. Of course, I always root for the child sometimes. Unfortunately, they don't wait, they don't get what they selected in the store. But Danielle thought that this ice cream spoon, and she made some suggestions that the grandma for your painting, this would be perfect. and you made it for your collection. We both collect. This is also, you can't just teach art by mandating things, writing things on the board, saying on the board, see many times on the board, be happy. But you have to be a participant, you have to be part of it, you have to get on the floor with the kids, you have to have collections that you share. In no time, they will start sharing their collections with you. So anyway, the old bag, in a sense, is kind of a history of what a school in Vienna and my growing up in America later on was like. America, we were supposed to sneak across the border at night, along with, it wasn't suspicious, along with 100,000 other Hungarians who were trying to sneak across the border. So, of course, the Russians caught us. But in preparation for the trip, my mother saw this, she knitted this wonderful sweater. And it's something that has great meaning to me. And my father had, we couldn't take anything with us, but my father had this leather jacket. And again, there were no stores, so everything had to be custom made. Made pockets that were big enough that we could carry as much as we could with us from Hungary. And of course, he wore his. This is something we wore. It's interesting because we wore these in Hungary to school and we wore this in Vienna to school. But I refused to leave the country if I couldn't take my toys. And it was interesting. You know, there were so many things that my parents wanted to take to perhaps have a little seed money to start in America. But George wanted his toys. So I'll just share with you what kind of parents I had and some of the soldiers that
I wanted to take with me are still here. And I painted like most kids. They paint everything. With nail polish, the phone. I remember the repairman coming in. I couldn't believe it. The repairman came in to fix my daughter's computer, and he couldn't find it. It was so heavily stickered. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. I couldn't find it. I remember with my wife buying this new suitcase, and it was supposed to be actually for a trip that I was taking. But by the morning, it was all painted. So every painting is a painting surface for children. And again, that's by watching them, part of their art, and suitcases, all kinds of personal containers are very much part of our shopping sites. This is my art room, and there are shopping sites all around. Some of them are camp trunks, some of them are old suitcases, hat boxes, and mentioned some of the others with little drawers. The kids need to shop for the things they want and make the things from that. Having Saks Art Supplies send you a stack of things and putting it in the middle of the table, it's already making the artwork for them. So the artist, as you do, right? You shop for your supplies, and it's the beginning of leading your ideas to different levels. So give the kids that opportunity to shop for things. And the art will change in the class completely. Am I running late? I'm running late, I'm sorry. It's supposed to signal me. Okay, let me talk. Okay, we're going to have some questions. We're going to talk to them.
Yeah, or questions.
Okay, so we will have some tea. Class, you know, that wasn't the start of it. It's like you're
outside of us, so during the winter I'm at goodwill.
I had a question. You mentioned one of the elements in your art room was your own artwork, right? Yeah, why is that important?
Jacob, my son, he's funny. He still remembers and swears that Miss, Miss Becky was the best art teacher in the world. And her, as a general classroom teacher, in first grade, and she still was the best art teacher because she was really in her artwork and posted it and having little shows of her artwork in the classroom. The children seeing us as artists is very important. The school seeing us as artists are very important. We're not just another teacher in the school. We are the artists in residence in the school. You must take special pride in that. And that will make a great difference in how you treat it in the school as well. We're very special, very important people in that school. I don't like the idea of the artist in residency program. When I was teaching elementary school, it's very annoying. The real artists coming in, getting all the money and newspaper coverage and whatever. Not that I was jealous, it didn't make sense. I was making art. I certainly considered my teaching this as an art form. So what of practice. You are the artist in residence. So you need to invite your colleagues, especially your principal, to have time with you. It's important, wonderful to adapt the school programs. But have lunch with your fellow teachers in elementary school and do some watercolor with them. Include the principal. Have a show of the elementary teachers. Like, that was a show that every teacher in elementary school looked forward to. The staff show. And it was so easy to organize because there's so many willing teachers. So building this relationship in an informal way, I think was something that I enjoyed doing and it made a huge difference. You know, teachers who come in the last minute and all they care about it is the line is straight, they couldn't care less, put your work away, you know, it's gonna, you know, take it home, I want to see it. Were they good? That was the other question that needs to ask me. Were they good? Were they gonna behave good? Not what they did. Would you come in a few minutes before, give up a little bit of your time and see what your kids are doing? So the relationship with your colleagues, that is tough, but you know, nothing like art to break that barrier. Please.
Anybody else?
I can really picture what this looks like in preschool. But as they get older, it's harder for me to imagine what the ideal, in this perspective of the ideal classroom, looks like a fifth grade, sixth grade. Do you have any anecdotes or things that you've seen, or you know, the kinds of stories you've been telling about younger kids, what was that look like?
We're still observing kids, and if we're talking about teens, if we're talking about high school students, middle schoolers, it's still the same question of observing the dynamic in various situations. I talked to you today about the teenagers in museums. We learn a lot from going to a teen actor museum. It is a different art, it's a different population, but you won't learn that by just going and observing the school class. you have to, again, do the same thing. See the kids, see their interests, and learn from the kids.
So, would you say that this applies to most people? I haven't heard of our students going into classrooms where there's an art room in the school, right? There's not an art room in most schools that we go into. And most of our students go into classrooms where they have to offer their art lessons between an hour, or really less, 45 minutes to at most an hour and a half if they're lucky and they have an open teacher. How does that work, you know, your approach work when there's not this beautiful arts rich space, which I know that's the idea, but the reality is that it's not. How does this approach work? How would you adjust the approach? Yeah.
If you look at the adopt a school program, it's very simple. In the middle school and high school, we work in the art teacher's room. In the elementary school, for the main reason, because they have art once every week or once every 2 weeks, we work in the classroom. But in the classroom, we also use the hallway a great deal as a teaching tool, where not just the group, let's say we took 5 secondary classes with one of our groups of students, but other teachers get to see this. And so to work in public and to use the hallway, I found very useful.
Do you bring all the supplies to the class each time that you would go? You know, there's no storage.
If there is anything else. It says the kids are eager to contribute their finds. I am never in trouble when kids once get started. You start in the middle of the semester, you start right from the beginning in these secret envelopes. And it's good to have this kind of playful, even if it's a shopping bag, to have this but if they start bringing in things and they know it's appreciated, it happens. So they become a contributor. And any time that a child uses their own art supplies, it's going to the same artist. Right? Are you going to use somebody else's supplies? It makes no sense. Anytime the child uses supplies that they found, it comes with ideas that they also found. So it's always better to work with their supplies. So they love to bring things in, and that's regardless of the way. Yes, please.
How long did it take you to actually put your thing together? How long did it take you to actually put your thing together for creativity? And exactly what goes on inside of your mind as a teacher and also teaching children, wonders of a child mind when you think was as creativity. Exactly what thought goes on in your mind was creativity, and how long did it take you to want to encourage them to keep doing what they do?
Or another version of that in my mind was,
yeah.
You're trained as an artist, you have an MFA in art.
Yes.
Were you trained to be an art teacher? Or how did that transition move from your art training, your studio art training, those professional art schools,
yes.
Right? They didn't teach you to work like this with children. How did you transition into this approach with children?
I must be very honest, it was looked down upon.
Right.
It's not something that you said.
Right.
That's
correct. It still happens now.
In your school, my school. Yes.
Right.
Yes.
So how did that work for you?
How did it work?
Did you know that you were going to be an art teacher when you were in the MFA program?
I'm going to be honest.
Yeah.
Because I wanted to pay.
Yeah.
That's all I wanted to do.
Right.
We had no more. And there were two school districts in New York City. same time, it was the humility, because I realized that I was not training. I was realized that I was a novice. At the same time, I knew I had to learn from the kids. So I sat back and I observed as much as I thought. And I still think that's a good idea. Step back. Have some tea. Come see.
One more question?
Yeah. I just want to ask if you see ways that this play and creativity and art can maybe take shape in classrooms that aren't necessarily art classrooms or arts-based classrooms?
It's totally about this. It's in every school that we go to. I send it on the list district-wide. We have about 60 schools in Kentucky. I send around a flyer who would like to participate in the Synoptic School program. It's been around a long time, so it has some visibility. And people sign up. And the people, you know, we try to get as many as we can each semester. With my art education majors.
I'm just curious, like just that sense of play and creativity.
Right, in other subjects is what he was talking about, right? How do you incorporate your open, explorative process approach in other subjects other than art? Yeah.
I must tell you, by working on sort of the street, the hallways, the street of the school, by working in the street and having so many classroom teachers see it. You have one art teacher in these schools, and you have lots of classroom teachers. So if you spend out in the hallway with your students, with, you know, 250 second graders, you're seeing. And it's something that
influencing the other teachers.
It influences the classroom teachers as well.
One last question. I know. I knew. Yes, everybody. Yes.
In your explorative style, yeah. To what extent is it standards based? And my real question is, if you must be the advocate for standards based in public schools, then what is your best line of defense to a principal, administrator, anyone? That what I'm doing is the correct thing. Never mind all of that.
There it is, right there.
Since I represent now the establishment,
love to see how you could interpret those for us.
Okay.